Hi, I'm Marge Easley, and this is Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 100-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, be sure to visit our online site, Vote411, before you mark your ballot. And today we have WLnsvey, Campos, candidate for state legislature. District 28. Hi, WLnsvey. Nice to have you here.
Hi, thank you.
And you're very welcome. I see your cats behind you, and we're happy to have them visit us too. I'm like you to start with telling us a little bit about yourself and what does District 28 include also, and why are you running for this office?
Yeah, so my name is WLnsvey Campos. I'm running for state representative of House District 28, and that encompasses the Alloa Beaverton area. It doesn't encompass all of Beaverton. It goes into downtown Beaverton, and districting is funny. Well-known coffee shop Ava's Roasteria is in the district, but you cross the street and you're out of the district. And then it extends up towards Murray and the Highland area of the city of Beaverton. And it includes Beaverton School District and a little piece of the Hillsborough School District. And okay. I work as the case manager for Family Promise of Beaverton. It's a transitional housing program that helps families experiencing homelessness get into housing. And it's the work that I do that was essentially the catalyst for me having made the decision to run. I had a number of different people in the community approach me about doing so, but I didn't think it was actually something that I was going to do until I had a day at work where I had one too many conversations with families about the lack of resources and solutions in the area. I started a day out on the phone with somebody who, by the end of the phone call, knew that they were going to be sleeping outside because all of the organizations they had called, including ours, were at capacity. I ended that day with a mom breaking down in tears in front of me, asking me how she was supposed to put a roof over her children's head when she works 40 hours a week but only makes minimum wage. And she laid out what those numbers meant. That meant she made a little over $1,700 after taxes, and the average for a two-bedroom in the area last year, which is what she was looking for, was a little over $1,300. And so after she left, I sat at my desk feeling really angry and frustrated. And I thought to myself, what we need is change at a policy level. We need people that are on the front lines of the most pressing issues, and we need people who have diverse lived experiences and perspectives. I myself grew up in a low-income household from the age of 8 until I left for college. My family lived in a motel room because that's what we could afford. There were times in my life we had to go to the public library restroom to literally roll sheets of toilet paper to take home so that we could save $8 that week and put it towards bills. I saw a lot growing up and had to grow up pretty quickly. I was my dad's translator at the age of 8, and growing up and struggling a lot in this household where my dad worked really hard to make sure that I had opportunities so that I could be the first in my family to graduate college, ended up instilling in me a sense of social justice and advocacy. And so I strongly believe that we need these voices and perspectives in the legislature, and I am here and ready to fight for and advocate for our most vulnerable communities.
Thank you. We are going to have some very tough budget choices in the next legislative session due to the economic downturn that will inevitably happen with the current crisis. So what are your top budgetary priorities, and where do you think legislators should start in trying to get those priorities passed?
Absolutely. Well, first and foremost, we need to support workers, and especially those who have been left out of federal relief funds. I support the Oregon Workers Relief Fund as COVID-19 continues to ravage low-wage employees, we continue to see a high level of unemployment in our communities. I actually just had a phone call about an hour ago with one of the families that I'm working with that is struggling to get through that system and really, really needs that to be able to pay rent and bills next month. And so we need to make sure that we are supporting workers. We also need to set up an emergency fund to support restaurant workers, caregivers, immigrants, day laborers, farm workers, those that are disproportionately impacted by this crisis right now. And then what the COVID-19 pandemic has clearly shown us is that we have had cracks in our systems for many, many years. And this crisis is only further exacerbating them. And so a lot of the policy issues that I have talked about on the campaign trail for many months haven't changed dramatically. My top priorities have been climate change, healthcare, housing. And right now, more than ever, we are seeing that folks in these communities are being left behind. So we need to make sure that housing is a priority. One of the things that my organization that I work for is concerned about is that right now we don't have rent relief or forgiveness. We just have a moratorium. And so when that moratorium is lifted, are we going to end up seeing an onslaught of evictions and an increase in the housing crisis that already exists? And so we need to make sure that addressing that crisis is a priority. And we need to make sure that we're addressing the inadequacies in our healthcare system. Right now, in the midst of a pandemic, there's so many people that cannot access healthcare that they desperately need. And so I've been advocated for and will continue to advocate for expanding the Oregon Health Plan.
Okay, thank you. The last two legislative sessions have been extremely divisive. Largely due to the cap and trade bill, the Republicans had a walkout. And so it makes makes the work of legislators very difficult. What can you do personally to help bridge that divide?
So historic in Oregon and incredibly frustrating to a lot of voters and constituents. I think a lot of us felt that if we had done that at work, if we hadn't shown up to do the work that we were being paid for, we would have been fired. And so we definitely need to address preventing that from happening again, because we just saw a legislative session that was incredibly ineffective. And I myself bring a number of different perspectives that works to bring people and different sides together. I will say that as a translator from an early age, I learned how important it is to really listen and hear people. And clearly there are concerns and one of the things that happens when we can't work together, more often than not, it's perpetuated by the fact that people don't feel heard. And one of the things that a lot of the skills that I have in my workplace require me to meet people where they're at, to really listen to their stories, their concerns, their issues, and to work with people who come from a variety of different backgrounds and experiences. And so those are skills that I bring in being able to work together and listen and understand. But I also have a history of bringing folks who are divided together. I, for a number of different years, 5+ years, volunteered for the Washington County Democrats. And in 2016, as a party, we saw some pretty divisive times. We had meetings where people hurled insults at one another, where people weren't willing to share the same space. And I managed to bridge that and remained friends and had alliances and acquaintances on both sides of it. And one of the things that's clear that shows clearly how I was able to bridge both sides is that I currently have the endorsement of the former county party chair who came up from, who was on one side of things, and then the current chair. I also have the endorsement of the current Washington County Democrats chair, who rose up more from the other side of things. And so those are the things that I will bring to make sure that we are working together. and that we don't have another legislative session like the one we just had.
Okay. All right. Well, it's been wonderful hearing your views on things, and we thank you so much for talking with us today. Please stay safe. And I just want to address voters and say, please don't forget to visit our Vote411 site for personalized ballot information. Thank you so much.